one now?
You're rolling.
Okay. Hi. I'm Turk Stokes. And tonight we have a very special guest, Mr. Tex Henson, who is a classic Disney animator who started in the 40s with Disney.
Not in the 30s, you know, in the 40s. Yeah.
In the 40s. And carried that in through the famous studios. He worked in New York for a few years, and he was around for the birth of the television commercial industry. And into the 60s, he worked on the Bullwinkle shows in Mexico. And here's Mr. Tex Henson.
Well, I'm also, I want to point out that I'm also classified as a film pioneer in the Third Coast. I'm the one that came back to the Dallas area and helped build the film industry here.
From scratch.
From the very beginning. So I'm, I take pride in that I was, when I went to work at Disney's, the only two places you could be in the film business was on the West Coast or the East Coast. There was nothing here. And I never thought I'd be back to Dallas. But you know, 15 years later, suddenly here was a film industry starting up, and so I came back here and participated in it, and kept trying to escape, but I just ended up hanging around, and suddenly I found myself with the status of being a film pioneer.
Well, I right before we started taping, you were mentioning something about the fact that you spent the night with...
I love the way these stories grow. No, I spent an afternoon in Liz Taylor's bedroom. She was 14 at the time, I believe.
Oh, not like 1,400 pounds.
And she had just finished making National Velvet. And we're out to her house, and she was, they had given her the horse. But she also had chipmunks and so forth, and so I was in her bedroom, and she was showing me all her little animals and so forth. And I made a prediction, because she seemed like a normal little girl, that there's one girl that Hollywood would never touch. I really know how to. I know how to pick them. Like when I during World War II, I was hanging around. I used to go up to the Dallas Morning News and hang around Jack Patton, who was one of the cartoonists there. And the one day, there was a baby-faced soldier from Fort Hood up there showing Jack some of his cartoons. And when he was gone, I looked him over. I said, "Well, he's just another Army cartoonist. Probably never hear him again." And that was Bill Mauldin. So I don't know what kind of prediction I got for you, but, you know, watch it.
Well, a lot of people need to know that Tex was one of the, of a team who created Chip and Dale for Walt Disney, and I'd like maybe you to tell a little bit of how that developed.
Well, what happened was that they'd been making a series of shorts with Mickey and Pluto and two chipmunks. Mickey and Pluto go up to a summer cabin, and the chipmunks are living in the stove, and when Mickey tries to light the fire, the chipmunks blow out the match. Well, and those things usually got rid of Mickey pretty quick, and majority of the short was about a play between Pluto and the chipmunks. Well, did about three of those, and Walt decided, well, why don't we try one with two chipmunks and Donald to see what we come up with. So Scotty Whitaker and I got the assignment to see where that would lead. And so Scotty and I decided to give the two chipmunks a little identity. After, you know, after that time, they were just two mischievous chipmunks. So we kept one, the regular chipmunk, and the other we gave a red bulb nose to a forelock and some splayed tooth like the Goof, and made him a little dumber. And we just needed a working name for the characters for the benefit of the studio, and so we just called them the first thing that came off the top of our head. You know, Chippendale Furniture, and chipmunks, we call them Chip and Dale. Now, they were never called Chip and Dale by name on the soundtrack. And of course, when we did the story and gave the direction the characters would be designed, but they really were polished down in the animation department in Jack Hanna's unit, which became the Chip and Dale unit. But when Walt saw that first pencil reel on that Chip and Dale short, he knew he had a winner. So he changed the name of the short to Chip and Dale, and they became standard Disney characters. Now, Scotty and I were never involved with Chip and Dale again, and it wasn't by any intent. Is that Disney's was and the animation industry, as is the whole motion picture industry, it was a factory process, and Chip and Dale just didn't happen to show up on our particular assembly line, and any time we could have ended up doing another Chippendale story or working on Chippendale at the animation end, but it just never worked out that way.
So what other things did you work on for Disney? You did several.
Well, the thing is that the only other character I created for Disney was a character named Old Benttail, which was a coyote character with another bulb nose.
You just can't keep away from those bulb noses.
For Pluto, and I had high hopes for Old Benttail, but they did about three of those, and they never did anything with it.
You did, say Mickey and the Beanstalk?
Well, the features I worked on at Disney's was The Three Caballeros, which was the film about Mexico, and I worked on some of what they call package features, Melody Time and Make My Music, and then I worked on Song of the South, which is a sort of a classic, and then I worked on the Mickey feature, which was Mickey and the Beanstalk.
And I think earlier you were talking about Pecos Bill.
I did work as a story man on Pecos Bill, and I did work as a story man on Peter the Wolf. Now, you know, I've been working on duck shorts. I mean, I'm all of 20, 21 years old, and I'm printing the story department, and of course I've been working on shorts, and when they called about Pecos Bill, that was a chance to work on a feature, and they called about Pecos Bill. Well, I knew that Pecos Bill was a Texas legendary character, and I seen his name on a bookstore in Dallas at one time, and that was the extent of my knowledge of Pecos Bill. But right away I became an authority on Pecos Bill. I said, well, I grew up on Pecos Bill stories, know all about him. So they said, well, report to Jim Auger and story tomorrow morning. You're on the Pecos Bill story and the Pecos Bill unit. So that evening I went to the public library, got out a book on American folk legends and read the chapter on Pecos Bill. So when I got there the next morning, well, I knew as much about him as anybody. In fact, I knew more than most of them.
And that's the American way, isn't it?
That's the American way. But anyway.
I remember you talking.